hear me now? Well, welcome back to the second of our lecture series. And let's see, just remind you that next week we're going to have a panel discussion on doing business in France. So we actually have the woman that's head of the Chamber of Commerce dealing with French businesses from Chicago coming in, and we'll have a lot of local French businesses coming and talking. So it'll be a panel discussion. They'll be doing some presentations, but they're going to be also mostly trying to see what kind of questions and so forth people are going to have. Then on October 16th, we will have a lecture on the French criminal justice system. And then finally, our own Graham Reed will finish this off with the underbelly of Impressionism. So I'm sure you're not going to want to miss that one there. My name is Chris Hayes. I'm an anthropologist here, and I chair the lectures committee. And it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker. He earned his PhD from Michigan State University in French Sociolinguistics, and he's been at UWM for 17 years. He's currently the chair of the French, Italian, and Comparative Literature Department, and as well as the coordinator of the Food Studies Certificate Program. His research focuses on language, language perception, and the language of food.
Well, it's actually very fitting and appropriate to have an anthropologist introduce me here, because I think most anthropologists will tell you that if you want to figure out what a culture from many, many years ago was doing, first place you go, correct me if I'm wrong, is to see what they were doing with their food.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And so we're not going to go back that far, necessarily. But I do want to start off with just a sort of a, I've got three quick video clips. I'm not going to say anything about them. I just want to show them, have you internalize them, and then we'll move on with the presentation. The first clip is a little bit longer than the other two. It's 3 minutes, so I think we can get through 3 minutes. It's an advertisement for a grocery store in France. Oh yeah, we're gonna get the advertisements here real quick. An advertisement for the advertisement. Okay, there we go. You don't really need the sound, but you'll get the idea. Thank you. Okay, so that's, as you can imagine, I had a little trouble finding 3-minute long commercials from American grocery stores, but I did find a couple of 30-second ones that I think fit more or less the sector that Intermarché fits into a little bit. So I'm just going to play these again with no comment.
At Whole Foods Market, we believe in food that's naturally beautiful and fresh, delicious and powerful, and full of nutrients. Food that makes us nourished and mighty, and connects us to the natural world. So there are no artificial colors, no artificial flavors, no artificial preservatives in any of the food we sell. We believe in real food. Whole Foods Market.
And finally, pick and save. Something I'm sure we're all.
Here's to the tailgateaholics, the connoisseurs of cheese, the hot party platters.
What's going on? Hold on.
Successful ice fishermen. We tip our cheese shaped hats in foam to you because you are true Wisconsinites. And Pick and Save is proud to be the place you go to save on thousands of grocery items every day. After all, we're from Wisconsin too, don't you know? Pick and Save, where Wisconsin saves on groceries.
Okay. So that's that. Go away. Stop. Close all. All right. No comment. I'm not going to make any comments on that. We're going to come back to that. This is what I want to kind of try to cover in this talk. As there's a lot of ground. Cuisine and culture are two big words, and then to try to put them together, it's a task. So I'm going to try to do my best here. How is French cuisine the same as other cuisines? How is French cuisine different from other cuisines? How and why has French cuisine taken a unique place among world cuisines? And finally, how is it different in the everyday from what we're used to here? These are all kind of things that I try to touch on a course that I teach at UWM on the Milwaukee campus. But I get a whole semester to do it there, so I'm going to try to do it in a little more consolidated fashion here. So one of the first questions that I always ask my students when they come in is, what is cuisine? And of course, cuisine is a very loaded word in English. It doesn't just mean food when we say it in English, but it is just the word for food in French. But when we attach it to a nationality in English, it often loses some of that sort of sophisticated value that we give it. If we say Indian cuisine or Mexican cuisine or something like that, it kind of comes back down to earth a little bit. But when we compare the term food to the word cuisine in English, there are all kinds of connotations. Probably simply because one of those words is French, right? So there's a lot to unpack there about why that difference is in our psyche somewhere as Americans when we say cuisine. Cuisine is an English word, but it's also a French word. There's one very excellent scholar named Sidney Mintz who kind of tried to unpack all of this terminology and get us to understand what cuisine really is. And then he made a distinction between what he calls cuisine and what he calls haute cuisine, which is French for kind of high cuisine. Fancy cuisine or something like that. One of the questions that he asks, and we won't try to unpack this completely here, but one of the questions that he asks in his book that I will reference here at some point is does every culture have a cuisine? And he specifically asks, does the U.S. have a cuisine? And then he tries to figure out, how can we decide that? How can we decide whether a country or a culture has a cuisine that is its own or not? So he sort of tries to tie those things to ethnic identity, national identity, and then regional identity. And he basically says that all cuisines have these elements. An attachment to some local ingredients, right? So it doesn't have to be all local ingredients, but there has to be some attachment to some local ingredients. We also know that those local ingredients change over time. For example, I don't know if I don't know if the term Columbian Exchange is just something that I've spent too much time reading about, so it's common to me, but the Columbian Exchange is the term that's given to all of the foods that found new lands after Europeans came to America. So it's impossible practically to imagine, for example, Italian cuisine without tomatoes. Yet before Europeans made it to the Americas, there were no tomatoes in Europe. So we can't say that this is fixed to things that grow indigenously in one place, because tomatoes are not indigenous to Italy, for example. Potatoes are not indigenous to Europe at all, came over from the Americas as well, and so on and so on. There are lots of examples like that. In fact, the chili peppers that are used in Mexican cuisine were imported there from China, and so on. So this Columbian Exchange was very wide-reaching and changed cuisines all over the world. But the second thing that all cuisines share is this sort of cultural awareness about the authenticity of the cuisine. So, I think around here you could very easily hear someone saying, oh, that's not a real cheese curd. You got to try a real one, right? Like, we know, because we live here, we know where the real ones are, and we can tell people, right? And so we all sort of, the longer we're here, the more we can kind of, I've been here, by the way, I've got to update my biography. I've been at UWM for 21 years now, but anyway, and so I've grown to understand what that real cheese curd is, because I've learned from people who've been here their whole lives, and so there's this sense of authenticity. And then there's also this, usually attached to a cuisine, there's this idea of process. if you're taking shortcuts to do something, you're probably not doing it right, right? If you're making some local dish that it took grandma 8 hours to make and you're doing it in 2 hours, something's up with that, right? We know about process. We know what it takes to get us to that dish that is authentic. So those are three ingredients, so to speak, for a cuisine, for defining a cuisine and attaching it to a culture. That's the name of the book, by the way, down there. Sydney Mintz, Tasting Food, Tasting Freedom, if you want to read a little bit more in depth about these concepts. I find it very interesting. So how would this apply to French cuisine? And see, here's where we run into problems. France has been changing so much over time that the idea that we have of France today has nothing to do with what France, quote unquote, looked like 300 years ago when the local cuisines were developing. So that's a difficult issue to understand when we talk about French cuisine. how can it be local when it's this amalgam of all of these different localities, right? In the same way that Wisconsin would not claim Cajun food as its local cuisine, right, just because it's still in the United States, I don't think that you would go to France and say, oh, you got to try some of that good, you know, food from where I'm from, you know, like crawfish etouffee, right? You would say things from Wisconsin, and that's the same thing that you have in France. The three things that Mintz talks about are true in France at a national, regional, and at sometimes very local levels. So how do we tease all that out? First of all, let's look at France's geography a little bit so we can understand what we're talking about here. So four Wisconsins are one France. Okay, so that's how big France is, which means it doesn't seem like it's that big in comparison to the United States. It seems like a very small country. But in looking at this another way, so Wisconsin, I just learned this today, Wisconsin is the median state in the United States. Means there are exactly as many states that are larger than Wisconsin as there are that are smaller than Wisconsin. And actually, if Wisconsin were a country, it would also be pretty close to the median country, meaning that about half of the world's countries are smaller than Wisconsin, and about half of the world's countries are larger than Wisconsin. And that's pretty interesting, because that puts it in a new light. France is, therefore, four times larger than the median country in the world. So in the grand scale, it's a fairly large country. But there's another way to think about this. When these cuisines were being formed, when these cuisines were being made in these little pockets of France, France was a much larger country in some ways. Because these cuisines were being formed in a period before we had railroads, or the fastest transportation was a horse and carriage, and it could go about 15 miles an hour at a steady clip if it had good roads the whole way. And so to cross France horizontally took 3 to 4 weeks in those days, and to cross it vertically from north all the way to the south could take as much as 2 months. So that changes your sense of scale when you think of it in those terms. And by the way, another really great book I'm going to throw up there for you, Graham Robb's The Discovery of France. He actually realized that the speed of these horse and carriages was about the same speed as a bike. So he decided to revisit France on that scale, using a bike, and kind of go across France and try to rediscover it. In that way. And it's a really interesting read, because then he took a few years to research the things that he saw and did, and highly recommend it. Really easy read and a lot of fun. So when we start thinking about the geography of France in that way, it kind of changes our sense of, oh yeah, I see how there could be many different cuisines, right? It doesn't have to be as far apart from each other as Louisiana from Wisconsin anymore, right? It can be pretty close and still represent a lot of distance in the times when these things were being formed. And also, and this goes well into the age of the car as well. In fact, I was watching the PBS special on country music a little bit ago here. I don't know if any of you got a chance to see some of that. And they were talking about the Carter family, right? Wanting to go into Bristol, and I can't remember, it's something like 26 hours it took them to go 50 miles or something. You know, this is crazy, you know, because the roads didn't get really good until the mid-20th century, right, to be able to really travel quickly. So these are some of the historical regions of France. This is just a sort of random chunk of them. There are many more regions within these regions. This is the bulk of the regions that existed at the time of the Revolution. But there were regions within these regions that had old roots. And then, you know, as you may know, the way it worked in medieval times is that things sort of consolidated by little regions, giving oaths of fealty to larger regions, and so on. So even after these many regions became sort of larger regions, there were still lots of local autonomous cultures within each region. A count or a knight could control a whole area, including its administration and what kind of crops were raised and so on. So you have here, this just gives you a sense of, you know, there's about 30 there. And within each of those 30, there's probably 5 or 6 more at least of local regions, localities. And as you travel across France even today, you will go into restaurants and see on the menu local specialty, and it'll have some crazy name like Quercinois or, just something from the very local region that you're in, a word that you've never heard before. And I still find myself sometimes saying, what does that word mean to the local? And they're like, that means it's from here. You know, that you get that a lot in France. So then if we look at the kind of things that split these regions up in France, if you look at a map of Germany, which is right next door, it doesn't look anything like this. France is run across with rivers. This is not all of the rivers. This is just the main rivers in France. And so, as you can imagine, traveling in the Middle Ages was very difficult from one region to the other, so it was just much easier to stay at home and make your own stuff. You also have, very, very fertile land between these rivers and lots of crop diversity, much more so than anywhere else in Europe at the time. The other thing about the French, the diversity of France is in a country that we think of as so small, there are no fewer than 4 mountain ranges. So as you know, when you go into a mountainous area, the climates and the things that can grow and everything change very, very abruptly as you go through these mountainous areas. And so the variety of things that can grow in France is incredible for such a small area. In fact, even today, France is the second largest exporter of agricultural products after the United States. For a country that's smaller than the size of Texas, they still are the second agricultural exporter in the world. And so that's just to give you a sense of how hard it is to actually pinpoint where does French cuisine come from. I'm going to go back to these regions. The place that you see up there called Île-de-France, right? That was the only place that was called France in the Middle Ages for quite a while, just that little region up there. And it just gradually sort of moved out. But the nation of France doesn't really consolidate until by the time of maybe Louis XIV, you start seeing a map that sort of looks like it does today. So well into the 17th century. So there are many hundreds of years where the thing that we think of in our head as the map of France doesn't exist for anybody. And the first time that France is called the hexagon, which is its nickname for the shape of the country, that doesn't come until well into the 18th century. Somebody actually refers to it as the hexagon that late in the game. So it doesn't reach its boundaries that it has today for a very long time. Okay, so, whoops. What does that have to do with anything? Okay, so one of the things that we know, that when we're identifying a cuisine, one of the things that we can do is identify it by its base fat. What is the main fat that is used in making a cuisine? So if we say olive oil, one immediately thinks of Italian or Greek food, right? That's the base fat for those cuisines. And most Mediterranean cuisines, the base fat is olive oil. Here in Wisconsin, probably cow-based fats, right, and so on. Well, France has sort of, I purposely made these boundaries like very fluid because they're not really, like it isn't like you step into one part of France and suddenly they stop using milk. That's not how it works. So I purposely made it kind of look gobbledygooky there. I'm better with Photoshop than that. I did it on purpose, really I did. But down in the southwest, as you go toward the southwest, you get more cuisines that are based on duck fat, pork fat, and goose fat. In the most of the north of France, the cuisine is based on dairy and cow fat products. And in the southeast, it's olive oil. So that's part of the diversity of French cuisine and also tells us a little bit about why France ended up being that country that came to the forefront of cuisine in the world for quite a period of time. So that's sort of the beginning of the answer to that question. Because if you go anywhere else in Europe, you're going to find that the cuisine doesn't have 3 different base fats kind of at a crossroads within the country. Usually a country has, you know, 1 major base fat. This is, by the way, again, this is fluid. Of course they use some milk and cheese in Italy. That's not to suggest that they don't, but Italian cuisine for many, many, many years was based entirely on that and so on. So these aren't hard and fast rules, but the idea that to have this many in one country sort of at a crossroads right in the middle does lend itself to their ability to then have a diversity within their national cuisine later when they become a nation. So when you go to France to buy a cookbook, you're going to end up buying a cookbook that has, is Norman cuisine or Touraine cuisine or Languedoc-Roussillon cuisine or Bourgogne, cuisine from Burgundy or cuisine from the north and Picardy and cuisine from Brittany. And wherever you go in France, the main restaurants in the towns that are trying to attract us as tourists, right, are trying to tell you, we don't it's not French cuisine that we do. We do our local regional cuisine. That's what we do. So one of the answers to the question, does France have a cuisine, is kind of unfortunately, according to the definitions that we've seen so far, there's really no such thing as a local French cuisine. Right? It's all regional. It's all local. So that's a fair question to ask. It's a fair question. Is there really a French cuisine? Is it just a hodgepodge of regional cuisines? But what about French dishes that do transcend region? When you do go to France, there isn't a town that doesn't sell croissants and baguettes. And then there are the bistro specialties. Any town you go to, you'll find has specialties like cassoulet or pot-au-feu or steak and fries with beurre, maître d'hôtel, saumonière, blanquette de veau. I put some pictures on here just to make you hungry. In that order. So these are the simple dishes that belong to the sort of class that we call bistro food in France. And you see a lot of them in Paris, but bistros are all over France. And so this might be the answer to the question, right? Is there a French cuisine? Yeah, it's probably somewhere in here. And that leads us to another sort of interesting thing that makes French cuisine the same as other cuisines. The working class, upper class food carousel exists everywhere in the world, and it exists just like it does here. It exists in France. The bistro dishes were all dishes that were eaten by factory workers. When they would come out, it was the simple food that was tough cuts of meat, for example, tough cuts that needed a lot of preparation. Does that sound familiar at all? Barbecue in the United States is another example of that, right? Tough cuts of meat that need lots of preparation that make their way from being working class food. They get on this carousel and they end up being, go buy ribs at a restaurant now, right? It's super expensive. I mean, from my perspective, it's very expensive stuff. But it didn't start out that way. And there are lots of foods that follow that carousel. In France, bouillabaisse, I don't know if you've heard of bouillabaisse, but this is a fish and seafood stew that they make in the southeast. This originated as, this was the stuff that was left over after the fishing nets had been cleaned out, right? And so the sailors would throw that into a pot and, well, you got to figure out a way to make it taste good. So they would, you know, find some herbs and things to throw in there with it and, you know, cook it for a really, really, really long time. And lo and behold, here we go. We've got bouillabaisse. And now, of course, bouillabaisse is every chef has their, this is, you know, my version of bouillabaisse and so on, right? So it's made its way along that carousel up to the top as well. Quenelle de brochet is another one that maybe you don't know, but that's kind of a kebab made with pike from the rivers in France. But the same idea, pike meat that's just ground up and then made into sort of a ground meat that you put on a skewer and cook slowly over the fire. Any sausage originates in this way, right? Sausage is bad cuts that get ground up together and put in a casing and made palatable because that's what's left over after the good meat gets bought by the people who have the money for it and so on. Yogurts, cheeses, beers, and many wines were all just ways of trying to preserve things in their origin, and then, of course, they've made their way up or not, depending on which culture you're in. Yogurt in many countries is still just a staple, but in some places you can go and you can get a fancy made-in-house yogurt and so on and so on. So crepes, galettes were originally, crepes were made as food for Lent in France. The idea was you couldn't have anything leavened, so you would make this flat flour and egg thing, right? And then you could eat that because it wasn't leavened. This was back in the Middle Ages. Then the galettes are just a buckwheat flour version of that. Any tripe dish obviously started in the lower classes. Many of them still are there, and so on and so on. And this is very similar to things that we see in the United States. Ramen restaurants are popping up all over Milwaukee. Ramen is working class Japanese food. And now it's become a very kind of high class, you know, let's go out for ramen, right? That's not how it worked when ramen started out in Japan. Ribs, I already mentioned. Lobster, as you may know, was at its origin eaten by the fishermen who would catch them in their nets out in the Grand Banks when they were fishing for cod, and they would get some lobsters caught up in there. And, you know, lobster's really hard to eat. It's not like, you know, I mean, but now it's pretty much the symbol of high class eating is something to do with lobster, right? Either lobster thermidor or something like that. But lobster originated in that way as well. The spiral black bread, brown bread, white bread, white bread at the turn of the 20th century in 1900 or so, white bread was seen as the food that the high upper classes ate. And now it's that, you know, 20 grain multi whatever, right? And the black bread was what poor people ate. So this is a common thread between all cuisines, right? And so this is something that I think French cuisine shares with all cuisines. So we're still on that part. Oh, and mac and cheese. I put mac and cheese up there because there is officially a gourmet mac and cheese restaurant opening on Brady Street in Milwaukee in the next month or so. I'm like, really? Mac and cheese. Okay. So how is French cuisine different? So French cuisine has lots of firsts. One of the things that France did before any other country was the restaurant. One of the reasons we know that is because the word for restaurant is the same in almost every language, and it's like the French word. And yet, it doesn't really have anything to do with what a restaurant does. That word is actually only vaguely related to the notion of what happens in a restaurant. Briefly, I'll just sort of outline that story in a minute here. Appropriation of culinary, of cuisine through codification, so I'll touch briefly on that. Appropriation through the notion of terroir, which is a deeply French notion about where food comes from and how it's very attached to where it comes from. The cultural elevation of cuisine, chefs become artists, and the history of French cuisine has movements and innovators and so on. So, and then finally, cultural exportation. Those are the things that make French cuisine different. So the invention of the restaurant, I threw another book up here. If you're interested in these kind of things, this is a great book about that. The invention of the restaurant, it's sort of an odd thing to think of the restaurant being invented, first of all, right? But before the restaurant emerged in Paris in the early 19th century, you had the style of eating out, if you were to eat out, was in a place like an inn or a tavern. And what you did was you went into that place and they were serving something and you ate that. That was how it worked. They didn't hand you a menu with choices. It was, tonight we're serving this. Would you like that? And they might have two choices, but that was about it. The restaurant, the innovation of the restaurant then was to have a menu, here are your choices, and so on. And why did it get invented in Paris just after the French Revolution? This book tells the story very well. The sort of short version of the story is that once the Revolution broke down all of the guilds that required pastry makers to be only pastry makers and meat roasters to only be meat roasters and so on, those guilds broke down. And so the only people that had any power to actually bring people from those different guilds together were people who worked for nobles. And so there was a natural sort of marriage of these people into a new business. These guys that used to bring together banquets in the chateaus of the nobles were out of jobs, so they said they got with their rotisserie buddies and their bakery buddies, and they said, let's start up a new place, and we can just give people choices, and they can come in. And what they did was they started using these sort of alchemists' houses where people used, before the revolution, they would go in and they would drink these broths that were called, that were restorative broths. So they would drink these broths to get healthy, right? Well, those places kind of died out with the revolution a little bit, but the broths were called bouillon restaurant. Restorative, restaurant means restorative in French. And so they just took these places over and called them by that same name, restaurant. And that's why that's the word in various languages slightly changed all over the world. But that started happening in Paris. And in the 1830s or so, you start seeing letters back home from people like Charles Dickens or other authors from America writing back home, you're not going to believe this thing they have in Paris. It's so cool. You go in and you just, they give you a list of things and you choose. And so that's the idea of the invention of the restaurant. So that's one of the big French firsts. Appropriation through codification. Any of the sauces that you hear of, Hollandaise sauce is one of the mother sauces, invented or codified first by Escoffier. Hollandaise just means Dutch, right? It's just the French word for Dutch. But he said, this is how the Dutch have this sauce. Let me show you how. Now everybody in the world calls it Hollandaise sauce. They use the French word for Dutch. This is the idea of codification, appropriation through codification. They kind of, the French kind of said, yeah, we're going to write this down, and that means it's basically ours at this point. Espanol sauce means Spanish sauce, right? But many other sauces, these are the mother sauces that Escoffier put in his 1903 groundbreaking book on how to run a restaurant. And but many, many other sauces that he created using these as the basis, right, also bear names of other regions in France or other countries, right? So Béarnais sauce is from the region Béarn, which is way down in the southwest of France, for example, and so on. So this is something that Escoffier very consciously did, was to say, this is the way that all restaurants should work. And he put together the brigade organization system, and this is still the system that most restaurants use. They set it up with you have the garde-manger, and you have the prep area, which has another word in French for it. But when you go to a culinary school, these are the terms you learn. And this is, in many cases, the book that you use. The Culinary Institute of America has a restaurant where all of the food that their students make is served. It's called the Escoffier Room. So Escoffier sort of put that out there, and nobody has diverged too far from that at this point. It's sort of the basis for all understanding in restaurants, if you're going to run one. They also used terroir as a way to appropriate prestige with food. You're not allowed to put champagne on your bottle if it doesn't come from that region. Roquefort, I don't know if you're familiar with, blue cheese used to just be called Roquefort cheese in the United States. The French said you can't do that anymore. And there was actually a trade war about this. In the late 90s, some sheep farmer in Roquefort-sur-Suzon went with his buddies, and they all took their tractors and tore down a McDonald's in the middle of France as a way to tell Americans to stop putting tariffs on Roquefort cheese. Because Americans were saying, well, look, we can chemically reproduce the exact bacteria that's used to make Roquefort cheese, and we can reproduce the exact conditions of your caves, and we can reproduce the actual bread that you use that you age and then crumble up into the mixture and so on. We can completely reproduce that process, so we should be able to call our cheese Roquefort. And this went to the World Court in The Hague, and The Hague decided in favor of the French, because the French's argument was, yeah, but the sheep that we get our milk from graze from this spot. And that was the final argument that won the day. Bordeaux, Burgundy. When I was growing up, you would see fine Burgundy wine from Ernest and Julio Gallo of California. You no longer see that anymore. They're not allowed to call it that anymore. The American solution to the Burgundy and Bordeaux problem was to just start naming the grapes. And that's why a Pinot Noir is a Burgundy, and a Cabernet Sauvignon is a Bordeaux, and so on and so on. They just went with that kind of naming, and that's why everywhere in the world names the grape on the bottle, except for France. They name the region. And then cultural elevation. If you read a history of French cuisine, you read about the great masters and the innovations, and these are just some of the names, and I won't go too deeply into all of them. I'll just tell some brief things about them. Taillevin wrote the first French, quote-unquote, cookbook in 1326. Varenne wrote one that is still being used today called La Varenne Pratique. I have a copy at home. It's awesome if you know anything about cooking, but you need to know something about cooking. It wasn't written for someone who wanted a step-by-step, but if you have a good idea about how to cook, La Varenne Pratique is a great cookbook. Vatel, there's a movie by this name, Vatel. Has anybody seen it? No? It's kind of cool. You can check it out. I think it's on Netflix now. Vatel is famous for having thrown a three-day party for the king in Chantilly. Chantilly is just outside of Paris now, but in the day it was, a two-day ride from Paris. And the king went there for a weekend, and on the third day, when he was supposed to do all the seafood, because it was Sunday and it was going to be all seafood, and he had all these ice sculptures, and then someone came to him and told him that the seafood was not going to arrive, and so he killed himself. So he's kind of a legend in that sense, taking one for the team. Like, sad part of the story is, a couple hours after he killed himself, the seafood arrived. Oops. Anyway, he probably had other stuff going on, I think, right? Carême was the first major maker of these huge food sculptures. He used to build these sculptures. He would say, I'm going to make a whole Parisian neighborhood out of food, and then when the guests arrive, they can eat their neighborhood, right? I have a great quote from him. I was trying to find it. I had it in French, but I thought, probably better with the English. And my favorite quote by him is, the fine arts are five in number. Namely, painting, sculpture, poetry, music, and architecture. The principal branch of architecture is pastry. So that's Carême. Brillat-Savarin was a famous, he made up rules about what it means to be a good eater rather than to be a good cook. So he's kind of famous for that. He has a book called The Physiology of Taste, which is absolutely hilarious in some ways, just the rules that he comes up with. He has these great little aphorisms, little sayings like a meal without cheese is like a bride who has only one eye. I don't even know what that, but anyway. And then Duglaret is famous for having served a meal to three emperors at the same table in 1866 at a restaurant called the Café Anglais. If you've seen the movie Babette's Feast, Babette is the chef from the Café Anglais in that movie. So Duglaret was the actual chef at the Café Anglais, and he served a meal to the Tsar Nicholas, Tsar Alexander, so Tsar Nicholas, the incoming czar and the outgoing czar, and Otto von Bismarck was there, and Kaiser Wilhelm was there. So he served this meal. If you go to Paris, you can go to that restaurant. It's now called the Tour d'Argent, but they still have the table set as it was at that meal. You can see it under glass. It's kind of impressive. Escoffier, we've already talked about. Paul Bocuse was the sort of first strident proponent of what they called Nouvelle Cuisine, which is this idea of making things really flavorful, but putting them in smaller, more well, in smaller dishes and smaller arrays on the plate. So these things where you see like sort of an artwork in the sauce and like a tiny little medallion of something, and that's the course. That was Paul Bocuse was a proponent of that. And Robuchon is today the most famous chef in France, and in fact, he's one of these people that you say his last name and everyone knows who you're talking about, like Madonna or whatever. Well, not like Madonna because he has a first name, but anyway, you get what I'm trying to say. So about the commercials. I come back to the commercials just briefly here because I think I want to open it up for questions. But my point with the commercials, maybe it came through, maybe it didn't. But the thing about the commercials is that the French commercial is seeing this cuisine as seeing the food in a tradition that includes art. And art is at its core a way of communicating. And so the food in that commercial, this is a grocery store commercial, right? But the food in that commercial is almost entirely about how do I connect with the people around me? I'm not saying that this never happens in the United States. It's not my point. But my point is that these are marketers who've decided to try to reach a large audience in a specific way. And that's the way they've chosen. There's nothing in that video about price, right? There's nothing about nutrition. There's nothing in there about feeling the best that you can feel in your body, right? Like we heard in the Whole Foods thing. It was all about making connections. And not just the girl and the guy, right? But it was also the friends and everything. That's all that commercial was about. The two American commercials, the Whole Foods one, was pretty much about nutrients and about making sure your baby's healthy and making sure that you're healthy and making sure that you feel good and you as an individual feel really good. So it was really that idea that food is a sum of the nutrients that you can put into your body. And then, of course, the Pick and Save one, I love that commercial, by the way, and this doesn't mean, I don't mean either of these things as criticisms as much as just remarks on the differences between the way food is treated by the two cultures. And in the Pick and Save one, there's a great deal of talk about price. It's about, hey, you can save a lot of money at Pick and Save. I mean, the name of the store is Pick and Save, right? So, but there's also this attempt to sort of connect things to local culture and so on. So it's not completely, you know, which insinuates connecting to each other as well and everything. So it's not bereft of those things, but I think that the main thrust of both of them, of both of the American commercials, are very different from the thrust of the French commercials. So, last thing I'll tell you is this quick story from Morocco. When I went to Morocco, I was sitting in a swimming pool in Marrakesh, and the guy that was sort of helping us out in the pool asked me and my colleague, Gabriel Verdier, who was one of the other people that helped develop this course I was talking about. He said, we started asking him questions about his life, as old professors do to young people that are waiting on them. And he said, I'm studying cuisine. I'm studying to be a chef. And we said, oh, really? Well, tell us about your courses. And he said, well, we've got a course in Moroccan cuisine, and we've got a course in East Asian cuisine, and we've got a course in Italian cuisine, and then we've got a course in world cuisine. And we said, well, there's no French cuisine course? He said, oh, that's the world cuisine. That's what that course is called. But it's clear that it's the French cuisine course, right? So that's kind of the status that French cuisine has taken in the culinary world, is it's just sort of second-naturedly thought of as, this is what we do. So French cuisine is world cuisine, is what he said to us. And then just to close that loop, the most popular dish in France right now is a Moroccan dish called couscous. If you haven't tried it, it's awesome. So I'll end it there and open it for questions.
System, we should have it done by next week. Well, you're going to probably need to answer the question, so I'm going to make, if you'll repeat the question if you would
sure.
hear it.
Then. Sure.
So, open up the questions then.
So, does America have a cuisine?
I would say that America, so if we're using it, if we're saying it based on the criteria that are set up there, I mean, I think that we could say that there are a number of things that all Americans have an opinion on in terms of what's the best of what, you know. So interestingly, I would say, for example, all of America, right? If we're talking about all of America, I would say pizza is something that, you know, you go from town to town. Every town has their style, right? Milwaukee has its style. Chicago has its style. New York has its style. So interestingly, we all have an opinion on how we like our pizza. We all think about process. Like, so that sort of fits into a general American cuisine. America has lots of regional cuisines, for sure. You know, no doubt about that. I mean, no question about that, right? But the number of things that you could call actual sort of overarching American cuisine are pretty, that's a pretty small number, I would say. Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty small. Yeah. Baseball, no. apple pie, right? Hot dogs, anyway. Hamburgers, for sure. Hamburgers, for sure, would fall into that.
Mm-hmm. What do you like to cook?
What do I like to cook? Well, I worked a lot of time in Italian restaurants, so I like to cook that. I like to cook Italian food. But I'm kind of a grill guy. Like, I like to, I do grilling and smoking and things like that. So. I do some French stuff, but that's very, so very tellingly, very special occasion stuff, right? Like, if there's like something really special going on, someone's anniversary, like mine, for example, or something like that. But I tend to go with simple stuff, you know.
So Julia Child didn't fall into any of these things?
You know what? Julia Child should be on that list, I think. I think she should. She just doesn't happen to be French. That's the only thing. Yeah. But the person that she spent so much time with, I should have put him on the list. No, I can't remember his name right now. Huh? Jacques Pépin. Yeah, Jacques Pépin is absolutely her. Those two together, amazing.
Simone Beck?
Mm-hmm. Simone Beck, huh?
You mentioned the Culinary Institute in Long Island.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. The one I was referring to was Poughkeepsie, New York, but that's okay. Yeah.
Well, that's upstate.
Yeah, yeah.
Does that really have a cachet outside of the New York East Coast area?
The Culinary Institute of America?
That's the
Culinary Institute of America, and I think they've even now opened campuses out on the West Coast, but that particular school has had a very large impact on, coming out of the Culinary Institute of America, at least in the 80s and 90s, that meant that you had a top-notch job right away, so it's had a huge influence on food all over this country, I think. I think if you went to the major restaurants in Milwaukee right now, the ones that are making the most sort of noise among food critics, I think you'd find there's at least one person in all of them that's from that school.
Huh? What do you think about the fact that less and less French restaurants make it on like the top 100 restaurants in the world?
The fact that, so what do I think about the fact that there are fewer and fewer French restaurants in the top 100 of the world? I think that's a natural evolution because I think what has happened is the French exportation of fine restaurant dining has been an utter and complete success. You go to any city in the world now, any city in the world now has at least one or two, I mean, even small cities, you know, have a number of really good restaurants. So it's only a matter of time that, of course, that starts to not just be a French thing, right? People are learning, and I think it speaks to the success of that cultural export.
So is it easy to seek out a real French cuisine if you go to various areas of France? Is it easy for you to go and find some real authentic, say, in Burgundy?
Yeah, well, I mean, what I do is I buy French guidebooks and I use those because the French guidebooks in general are written for people in Paris, right, because that's where the biggest buying public is. And so they're like saying, hey, Parisian, you want to find the real thing down in Burgundy or wherever, right? And so they're really trying to steer you there, a lot of these guidebooks. that are written for French people. Yes?
I'm going to bring it back to anthropology.
Okay.
Because when you talk about French cuisine and how it's become integrated to other kinds of cuisines, one of the dividing lines is this idea of the notion of disgust, if you will, because of the French inclusion of reptiles as edible, turtles, frogs, mm-hmm. and so forth, that don't make it into other kinds of cuisines or menus. So do you have some cultural explanations for that as a distinctive brand of the French cuisine and why that was not accepted in other places?
Well, I mean, I think interestingly, the only place in the United States where they do commonly eat reptiles is in Cajun Louisiana. So, I think disgust with certain types of food is deeply ingrained in a culture, of course. And so, yeah, it's the same thing with the kinds of Chinese food that you're going to find in the United States. You're going to find there are a lot of Chinese restaurants in the United States, and probably almost none of them are serving a lot of duck tongue, for example, right? So, I mean, I think that that's just locals make their decisions on those exports. But, you know, we grow up learning that, and it's really hard for us to...
But the irony is that in France that was turned into an elite.
So yep.
Eating those becomes precious or signs of what we're seeing, where here it's...
Right, exactly. It's, you know, yeah, so that's kind of that interesting... That's that interesting wheel, right? You know, so that's exactly right. You know, so the British, you know, were the ones that came up with the idea of calling the French frogs, because you are what you eat, and they're the only ones in Europe that seem to eat frog, and they were disgusted by that. So that becomes a pejorative term for the French. Yeah, I mean, I think that, but then. Somehow, some of these things sneak through. You know, it's interesting to see what sneaks through and what doesn't. You know, we're not eating any. There's a lot of Indian food being eaten in the United States, but nobody's eating insects yet. You know, but occasionally I see an article in the newspaper that's sort of like, we should start trying this. There's a lot of protein in those things. I think it's all part of that whole carousel of. What's high class, what's low class. I could totally see something like that becoming high class in the United States just because of the need for people in certain classes to distinguish themselves from others, but it hasn't happened yet, but you know. Uh-huh. No, I don't.
Twinkies?
Yeah. Well, that's interesting. I think the most disgusting moment I had with American food was when I was asked to open a restaurant in the basement of this theater in Kalamazoo, Michigan. It was kind of like, I don't know if you've been to the Oriental Theater in Milwaukee, but there's the huge basement, plenty of room for a restaurant. And there had been a restaurant in there, and then that restaurant had closed down, and it had been closed for 6 months or so. And so I came walking in, and there was some rotten food around, and that was kind of disgusting. But more disgusting than the rotten food was this chunk of American cheese that was sitting out on the counter, perfectly intact. And I was like, I don't think I want to eat that stuff. Yeah, Mary. I mean, I love the taste, but... I put my email address up here. If anybody wants to contact me, please feel free. I can send you the PowerPoint or any of the references or anything else that I'd be happy to share. So, thank you.
So, hope to see you next week here for the panel on French business.